Muslim world today. The recipes have been handed down through generations, and their forerunners are found in many medieval source books about food and recipes where onion and garlic feature prominently. The study of food and religion tends to revolve either around taboos or festival dishes. Rarely do we read about the development of a religious cuisine or about individual ingredients. This paper will look at the various discussions, usages, and conventions about onions and garlic in numerous Arabic classical texts, literary works, anecdotal collections, medical and pharmacological books, and treatises, as well as hadith collections that all form a part of the cultural heritage of the Arab and Islamic world. Historically, garlic and onion have been known as the oldest crops. Ancient cultures referred to them 5,000 years ago, and there is clear historical evidence for its use by the Egyptians, Babylonians, Romans, and Chinese. Ancient Egyptians believed that garlic and onion would aid in endurance, hence they fed them to their soldiers and to the laborers who were building the pyramids to increase their stamina and protect them from disease. A stela honoring Mentuwasser, an official, clearly shows the food being offered. His feast consists of loaves of bread, ribs, a hind quarter of beef, squash, onions in a basket, a lotus blossom, and leeks. Onions and garlic were also used medicinally for problems of the digestive system, sore throats, toothaches, and in the mummification process. Onion bulbs were found in mummy cavities, and it is suggested that they were used to stimulate the dead to breathe again. While garlic was also used in the embalming process, excellently preserved garlic was found in Tutankhamun's tomb, and dry remains of garlic and garlic bulbs made out of clay were found in other 18th dynasty tombs. The fourth book of Moses, titled Numbers, includes a verse: "We remember the fish which we ate in Egypt freely, the cucumbers and the melons and the leeks and the onions and the garlic." This passage refers to the Israelites when they were in the desert and remembered their diet in Egypt. Both onions and garlic are mentioned in the Qur’an, chapter 2, verse 61. I will just read a small passage of it. "And when you said, O Musa, we cannot bear with one food, therefore pray to thy Lord on our behalf to bring forth for us out of what the earth grows, of its herbs, its cucumbers, its garlic, its lentils, and its onions." This passage, like in the Bible, refers to the Israelites, but here they not only remembered, but they pleaded with Moses to call upon his God to change their monotonous diet. The tafsir literature mentions that the word fum, apart from garlic, could mean something else. It could mean corn, wheat, grain, or bread in general. And some mufassirun, such as al-Zamakhshari in his al-Kashshaf, explained this boredom by saying that before their desert days, these guys were farmers engaged in agriculture and missed the variety available to them, and that whoever eats the same diet daily eventually gets bored. Al-Qurtubi in his Jama' al-Ahkam al-Qur'an adds that they were remembering their days in Egypt, heavily borrowing from the biblical passage. Regardless of whether fum refers to garlic or not, the onion is mentioned. Hadith literature preserves several narrations attributed to the Prophet. It is narrated that he directed people to refrain from these two trees and said, "Whoever eats of these two trees should not come near our mosque." He also said, "If you must eat of these, then kill their odor by cooking." The narrator said that onion and garlic are implied, though neither onion nor garlic grows on trees. In some versions, such as, for example, in Ahmad ibn Hanbal's Musnad, the word al-khabithain, evil or vicious, was added to describe these trees. Another hadith narrates that the Prophet said, "Whoever has eaten garlic or onion should keep away from us," and in a different version, "should keep away from the mosque in general." Karen mentioned, barbers should also not eat. Anyway, according to other traditions, Muhammad merely expressed his personal dislike of them and forbade those who had recently eaten them to come to the mosque to avoid annoying other worshippers with flatulence consequences and bad mouth odors, and that he himself never ate them raw. In yet another narration, we are told that the narrator saw the Prophet direct a Muslim to exit the mosque to al-Baqiyah And in another version, he is even said to have taken the culprit by the hand and led him out. Al-Hakim al-Naisaburi mentions in his Al-Mustadrak that the Prophet explained when asked about it that he does not eat them because angels suffer from its odor and that he would be too embarrassed to receive them with this smell. Yet Aisha narrated that Abu Ziyad ibn Salama asked her about onions and she told him that the last food the Prophet ate contained onions. Furthermore, another hadith ascribed to the Prophet says, if you happen to enter a new land or acquire new territory, then eat from its onions and garlic as it protects you from its diseases. So onions also strengthen your stamina, increase the sperm, and reduce fever. So no wonder then, with all these conflicting narrations, that fiqh had to address the issue. Al-Shafi'i, in his famous Kitāb al-Umm, concludes that onion and garlic are not to be distributed as charity, as they cannot be eaten raw. This relates to a hadith in Ahmad ibn Hanbal's Musnad about a man called Mursid ibn Abdullah, who would always come to the mosque carrying things that he would distribute as charity. One day he came to the mosque carrying onions. Yazid ibn Abu Habib told him, O father of charity, why are you carrying this which will make your garments stink? He replied, by God, that was the only thing in my house. So I brought it to distribute it as charity. As the Prophet said, the charity of a believer will be his shadow on judgment day. The final verdict is that onions are not haram, prohibited, because the Prophet could not declare something as such when God had made it halal, allowed. Yet he could qualify the prohibition and make it dislike when its consumption is in raw form. The Prophet is also credited with saying, decorate your tables with pulses and onions, and frequently say the basmala, as that repels devils. In Egypt and Morocco, one was advised to keep garlic and onion under an infant's cot or cot mattress to appease the jinn. In ancient Egypt, garlic was perceived as a gift from the gods. However, in post-biblical mythology, it was believed that it had grown where Satan's left foot stepped on earth after he was evicted from the Garden of Eden, while onions grew in the print of his right foot. Eric Bloch states that this myth has Islamic origins, but I was unable to find it in any literature so far, but I'll keep looking. In Qamus al-Adat wa-Taqalid, Ahmad Amin writes that Egyptians believed that if a genie took a liking to a human and wanted to gift him something, it would be onion peel, and that onion peel would turn into gold after sunrise. Egyptians hang onions on the doors the night before Sham al-Nasim and put some under the bed and in rooms, believing that evil spirits would leave when they smelled the onion and would never return. From jinn to potions of the gods, aphrodisiacs are said to often possess a bit of the devil. An Indian legend about garlic's origin involves a jar hidden beneath the ocean containing the nectar of immortality. Gods and demons stirred the sea until the jar rose to the surface. The heavenly beings then succeeded in taking it first and distributed the elixir among themselves. However, a demon disguised himself as a god and to receive a share of the potion. One of the gods recognized the imposter and beheaded him before he could swallow it and become immortal. Garlic plants are supposed to have sprung up where drops of his blood fell to the earth. For this reason, garlic was considered a powerful substance that must be used with caution, for it contained demons' blood along with the elixir of immortality. It was believed that onions and garlic increased libido and sexual stamina. Hindus prohibit offering garlic in worship, and members of the Brahmin caste do not eat garlic because it arouses lust and desire. Ja'far al-Sadiq is said to have encouraged eating onions because they increase men's semen. In another narration, he is said to have attributed the increase of desire and potency for sexual intercourse to onions. In sexual health, Arab Muslim physicians such as Abu Bakr al-Razi, Thabit ibn Qurra, Ibn al-Jazzar, Ibn Rushd, and Ibn al-Nafis identified sexual and erectile dysfunctions and were the first to prescribe medication and therapy and drugs for the treatment and improvement of male sexuality. Among the medicine and food used were onion and garlic. though I fail to see how, I mean with the smell, but anyway. In the Sultan's sex potions, Nasir-ed-Din al-Tusi offers a recipe for garlic broth. It is made from fresh Syrian garlic, beef fat, spices, and it is credited with heating the loins. Another recipe to strengthen potency is made from onions, olive oil, salt, and spices. Recipes were not only used for potions to be consumed, but also for enemas that were said to increase sexual stamina. They were made from onion seed, leek seed, carrot seed, cinnamon, pepper, chickpeas, and lamb testicles. Ja'far al-Sadiq said that onions have benefits. They fight fatigue, increase strength, quicken the pace, and reduce fever. In another narration, he said onions improve the food's flavor, reduce phlegm, and increase desire and potency. The systematic control of food and drink in order to conserve health or combat disease is known as dietetics. Arabic medical writing in general, and dietetics in particular, started in the early 8th century. Hunayn ibn Ishaq and his son and nephew were among the pioneers of that genre. He translated Galen's dietetic tract called Kitāb al-aghdhiya on the property of foodstuffs. Abu Bakr al-Razi wrote several works on dietetics, including Kitāb manafi' al-aghdhiya وَدَفْعَ مَضَارِّهَا, the book on the benefits of foodstuffs and avoidance of their harmful effects. Garlic and onion were used both as food and for medical applications for thousands of years. Arab physicians prescribed garlic to induce profuse sweating, to help in the expulsion of waste through the skin, and to reduce fever. Onion juice was used to treat loss of appetite, coughing, and external infections. Cloves of garlic were inserted into ears to combat ear pain. Physicians used them for their antibacterial values to fight infections long before bacteria was even discovered. Hence, onion and garlic were used to disinfect surgical utensils, and sometimes surgical needles and scalpels were stuck into onions and garlic to keep them sanitary. In Pakistan, particularly in the Samahani Valley, garlic juice is used as a contraceptive and to lower blood pressure. In the Qamus al-Adat wa-Taqaleed, Ahmad Amin wrote that Egyptians believed that onions were very beneficial. They would squeeze the juice of the onion and use it as eye drops for infected eyes. For Ramad, conjunctivitis, they would add sheeh, wormwood, to these drops. When reviving a person who fainted, they would put some onion juice in his nose. In times of epidemics, Egyptians would smell both bulbs, onion and garlic, frequently, and would increase their consumption. Banquets were not only for kings and sultans, but for everyone, even if they varied in size and number of guests and food served. In his Fasl Khawatim Fima Qila Fil Wala'im, which Tariq mentioned earlier, Ibn Tulun identifies 13 different types of wala'im, feasts, according to their occasion, time of day or night, and gives advice on what to serve, when to leave as a guest, and on table manners in general. He advises the host not to serve raw onion, garlic, or leek. Another book in the same genre is Kitab al-Mu'akala by Abu al-Barakat al-Ghazni, which focuses on table manners and provides more than 80 tips and descriptions of what not to do at a table. Banquets revolve around food, and the earliest extant culinary manual, Kitab al-Tabīkh by Ibn Sayyar al-Warraq, late 10th century, contains evidence of a high culinary culture dating back to earlier times. However, this title was also used by many others. Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Baghdadi, Ibrahim al-Mahdi, Abu Ishaq al-Suli, Yuhanna ibn Masawai, and in addition to Kitab al-Tabīkh, also wrote a book titled Daf'a Madar al-Aghziya. In the book Kanz al-Fawaid fi Tanwi' al-Mawaid, which describes how to cook, the characteristics of a cook, how to create a varied diet, and types of utensils and foods, the cooks are advised to marinate fish and any type of meat in onion, garlic, lemon, and coriander, and to cook them all together so that the zafara, the pungent smell or fishy smell, would vanish. It also includes a chapter on aphrodisiacs and food that serves as medicine. Abu al-Tayyib Muhammad ibn Isha ibn al-Washi' or Ibn al-Washya' for short, wrote a book containing the code of behavior, manners, and customs of the Zurafa, the refined. They were refined in their manners, clothing, as well as in their eating and drinking habits. In his book, Kitab al-Zurf wal-Zurafa, also known as Kitab al-Muwashya', he devotes an entire chapter on the food of the Zurafa, and in it, onion, leek, cabbage, radish, and garlic are absolutely not to be consumed. Even if some of them fell into a dish by accident, then they should not even taste that dish. Ibn al-Jawzi defined the Zurafa in his Akhbar al-Ziraf wal-Mutamajinin as those possessing civility, manliness, refinement, eloquent, politeness, seriousness, chivalry, loyalty, piety, and discretion. And those who had bright faces, lean bodies, clean bodies and garments, those who smelled nice, were disgusted by dirt and bad deeds, had a sense of humor, were very generous, forgiving, and had all sorts of good traits. The Zurafa were eloquent and able to entertain and quote poetry and proverbs. Even if they refrained from eating onion and garlic, they could have quoted the proverbs that mentioned them, such as, bread and onion without care is better than meat with troubles, from Lebanon. Another two similar proverbs are from Egypt and Syria respectively. He who inserts himself between the onion and its peel only suffers from its smell or sting. The other version, he who inserts himself between onion and garlic will only end up stinking. So, in other words, meddling causes problems. One day honey, one day onions refers to the changing times and fortunes. You cannot get honey from an onion means that bad things can never result in any good. Because onions are cheap and nutritious, they were immortalized in the proverb as onions are a poor man's meat. Modesty and accepting circumstances is reflected in the moon is our lantern, onions are our apples. For the Subuh celebration, a week after birth, the Iraqis say, cut an onion and smell it, and the daughter will resemble her mother. In the Levant, those who deny their roots are admonished with, your mother is the onion, your father the garlic, so where is the good smell supposed to come from, you wretch? And in Egypt, an onion offered with love is worth a sheep. His onion is always burnt refers to someone who is always in a hurry. This is based on an anecdote about a peasant who was so hungry and kept pestering his wife about the warm meal, which was not ready yet. She gave him a piece of bread and an onion and told him to eat them until the food was ready. He wanted to make it special, so he put the onion in a clay oven and was impatient, so he kept taking it out and discovering it was not grilled yet. He increased the firewood and the onion ended up raw on the inside and burnt on the outside because of his haste. His story was immortalized in this proverb. As we have seen, loved and hated, sanctioned or condemned, recommended or rejected, both bulbs found their way not only into the pots or onto the tables, but also into proverbs, anecdotes, and literary outputs, and even on actual shops of the Arab and Muslim world through the ages. Thank you very much for listening.